Hi, this is my review of Postmortem Giallo, The Memorial. If you haven't seen my review of the other scenario slash adventure seat compendium slash location, please check out the playlist in the description below. I am going to put all of my reviews featuring Miguel Ribeiro's material there. In this case, The Memorial is a semi-sequel, I guess you could say, of the other scenario. There are some subtle references to that site and the situations that happened there, but they are very subtle. You could run this as a standalone scenario, as a one-shot, as a short campaign, so there's a lot of versatility to this horror scenario. Now, if you watched Orpheum Lofts, that is the first scenario, you may remember that these situations, the encounters that you can find in these modules, follow the tradition of the pulp subgenre of Giallo, which is a combination of thriller, mystery, horror. There's even a bit of comedy there. Now, let's start talking about the quality. The quality, I have a small criticism about it. I spotted two typos, one of which is fairly obvious. The module is called The Memorial, but in the first page you have The Memoriam, so that doesn't look very good. However, that's my only criticism. When it comes to the organization and the writing itself, it's pretty good. The document looks great with that graphic design, as if you are reading some sort of pulpy book, some sort of comic book, especially because of the illustrations that remind you of those Tales from the Crypt comic books. And the document is fully bookmarked, so it's going to be very easy for you to navigate your way through the entire PDF. So overall, the quality is great despite that error. Now, let's talk about the contents. The Memorial is quite different from Orpheum Lofts concerning the way that the plot develops. In Orpheum Lofts, you had this building with some subtle supernatural themes, but The Memorial is mostly based around sources like the TV series Reject, also One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest, The Killer Nun, just to name a few. There's also a bit of Scrubs and ER tossed in there as well. And before we go further, I must warn you that this review is going to contain spoilers, and this module is going to contain some pretty heavy stuff. That is cannibalism, necrophilia, torture, sexual assault. So you shouldn't play this with someone that is not mentally stable or emotionally mature. The scenario takes place in a decayed old hospital, the Ernest Spencer Memorial, especially in its psychiatric ward. This is a surreal institution, populated by bizarre people with a troubled past and where strange things occur frequently. Part of those occurrences is of supernatural origin, but some of them are illegal experiments and common medical malpractice. The hospital is also located in New York, like the other scenario, but you can place it anywhere you like. Now, concerning the time context, it is recommended that you run this during the late 1990s or early 2000s. Just like Orpheum Lofts, this document is system neutral. You can use it with any horror role-playing game, but it comes with stats for the role-playing game actual fucking monsters. So if you like to run that horror role-playing game, there's more reason for you to get this one. So the Ernest Spencer Memorial is located in the Red Hook neighborhood in Brooklyn. It was founded in February of 1925. It was originally specialized in neurology and neurosurgery. The investment in its construction and the acquisition of what was then the latest technology equipment was quite large, as the founders intended it to become one of the most modern hospitals on the East Coast. At the beginning, the Ernest Spencer Memorial lived up to the high expectations upheld by its founders, one of whom was George Spencer, a British-born surgeon, naturalized in the USA. George was the oldest son of Ernest Spencer, a brilliant doctor and a pioneer in neurosurgery, whose life ended tragically by an unexpected suicide. It was not long before aspirations turned into sour disappointment. A split occurred between the members of the administration, part of whom wanted to turn it into a general hospital, while the rest, including George Spencer, were concentrating their expectations in the long term, still wishing to wager on research and experimentation in the still recent and promising field of neurosurgery. The faction committed to profitability eventually won. After a few years of bitter conflict among members of the administration in 1929, shortly after the Wall Street stock market crash. However, the winning side didn't increase profits as expected. The Great Depression was not soft on the Ernest Spencer Memorial, and 1929 was just the beginning of a slow descent into oblivion. In 1935, in the midst of the hospital's growing crisis, George Spencer, ruined and discredited amongst his peers, committed suicide in his office, a tragic ending quite similar to that of his own father. The news of George Spencer's suicide contributed further to the decline of the institution. The Ernest Spencer Memorial was indeed a dream turned into a nightmare. 2.5 years later, after Spencer's demise, in 1938, an explosion in the hospital's basement, probably originating in a defective boiler, although this has never been proven, caused a fire. The flames consumed only part of the basement and caused damage to the ground floor. It was not a particularly serious incident. However, the hospital had to be closed for more than 2 months to carry out the necessary repairs. By that time, the memorial was no more than a shadow of what it was at opening day. In 1946, a new scandal shattered Ernest Spencer Memorial's reputation, which was already rather unfavorable. Illegal medical experiments in neurosurgery had been taking place in the psychiatric ward, led by physician James Mitchell. The police investigation brought to public knowledge information about Mitchell's macabre experiments on indigent alcoholics, schizophrenics, and the mentally handicapped. The Mitchell affair ended up as one of the worst stains in the hospital's curriculum. At least 15 people lost their lives in the experiments, while another 10 suffered irreparable damage. To make matters worse, Mitchell's notes revealed that the doctor himself suffered from severe mental disorder, and the experiments that he conducted were completely aberrant and without any scientific basis, merely the product of a devious and highly troubled mind. Mitchell was arrested and the psychiatric ward was closed for 2 years. After the aforementioned scandals, the history of the memorial differs very little from that of many other similar institutions. Even if the hospital has never met the ambitious expectations of its founders, the Ernest Spencer Memorial fulfilled its role with a modicum of efficiency. The financial crisis, which had started during the Great Depression, lasted a long time, and things only started improving by the mid-1980s, when Abraham Hershey joined the hospital administration. Hershey's policy of cost containment and severe wage cuts saved the hospital from bankruptcy, but further contributed to accelerate the decadence of both building and all its equipment. Today, the memorial's building is dilapidated on the outside and the inside. The facade is a testament to the hospital's years. It is quite obvious that it hasn't undergone restoration in decades, exactly since April 1958. Inside, some sporadic works have improved certain areas of the hospital, among them the lobby, renovated in 1989, and the intensive care unit, renovated in 1996. The wards, rooms, offices, and corridors, however, are in a deplorable state of disrepair. The paint is worn out, there are water infiltrations, cracks in the walls, faulty bulbs that are rarely replaced, serious problems in the electrical system that leave sections of the hospital without lighting for minutes. The problem hasn't affected the hospital equipment yet, luckily. And an old-fashioned and rusty plumbing. The overall appearance of the building is quite frightening. Patients and staff constantly complain about Ernest Spencer's conditions, but without practical effect, unless a really serious incident threatens to ruin what's left of the hospital's reputation, once and for all. Hershey won't be expected to invest more than is strictly necessary. Despite this, the CEO understands that the outlook of patients and their families is very important and has allocated a small budget to a public relations campaign aimed at improving public opinion about Ernest Spencer without having to spend lots of money. Now, there's an important question. Is there a supernatural threat in the memorial? Depending on how you handle this scenario, there may be an occult presence, or the Ernest Spencer may be just a strange and decrepit hospital where there are unethical experiments going on and deranged and incompetent doctors practicing medicine. So if you want to take the supernatural route, there are plenty of elements to use, featuring religious and surreal horror, punctuated with some nasty body horror as well. This scenario adheres to no official mythology, so if you want to add supernatural elements, the choice is all yours, from vampires to eldritch horrors. On the other hand, the hospital may become more of a dramatic backdrop rather than framing the plot, in which case the giallo approach will require less supernatural, or perhaps none at all. Now, there is a major influence here, surreal horror. The genre is most definitely horror, but with a touch of dark humor and a lot of bizarre and surreal occurrences. So whether you want to enhance the horror aspect or the comedic aspect or dramatic aspect, the document contains all the information to walk any of those paths, and to further aid this, you have lots of information to handle giallo in any way that you want. You have all of the details concerning how to handle the heavier or more gruesome themes. You could tone it down a bit with the advice and tips here. And you even have a list of filmography, so you can watch those movies or those series and get inspired. And something that I really like concerning the overall framework of the module is that the staff and patients can suffer all sorts of hazards, absurd situations, dangers. So you have a table to determine just that. Maybe you obtain a result of the surgical mask stock has been dwindling for long, but today a small fire in the storage room has rendered most of them useless. There are several surgeries scheduled for the day, and something must be done quick. Maybe you obtain the result of there is a covenant of witches in the hospital. They aren't crooked nose, pointy hat, broom mounted witches, but Wiccan worshippers, so they are more religious rather than philosophical. It works like a secret club, only female staff members can attend, something close to a women's version of the Hugh Hefner Appreciation Society. But one day, by accident during a ritual, they awaken an evil lesser demon. The creature isn't powerful enough to wreak havoc in the memorial, but it will do its best. And these are just a couple of examples of the hazards, the accidents and incidents that could occur. But the real meat of this module lies in the backgrounds, the agendas, the personalities of the different non-player characters. Let me talk a bit about some of them. You have Abraham Hershey. He is an overweight, short, bearded, almost bald individual. Always dressed in a formal way, he wears comfortable and old-fashioned suits, and a fedora to conceal his receding hairline. Hershey is 55 years old and has been the hospital's CEO since 1985. A graduate of Columbia University, Hershey tries to maintain a cordial relationship with the staff, although they know that he does not care about anybody else's interests. Hershey usually avoids direct confrontation by delegating in Martin Jacoby the responsibility of dealing with the most difficult situations. Hershey maintains a suspiciously upper-class lifestyle, lives in a luxurious penthouse overlooking Central Park, attends the best restaurants and the most exclusive nightclubs in the city. It is undoubtedly true that the building is decaying and poorly maintained. The equipment is old and in urgent need of replacement. The staff's wages are below average, but Ernest Spencer Memorial has kept the doors open, which before Abraham Hershey took office would not have been foreseeable. Hershey is most likely a villain, but to what extent? Is he aware of any supernatural events in the memorial? Is he trying to use them in his favor or just trying to cover up? Then we have details on Martin Jacoby. He is tall and burly. He has short brown hair and blue eyes. Keeping his good shape was never a priority for Jacoby. He consumes all kinds of harmful poisons and eats like a pig. Nevertheless, his uncommon stamina allows him to overcome every one of his bad habits without major health problems. Jacoby is a lawyer a member of the board of directors and Hershey's right-hand man. Persistent and loyal like few others, Jacoby tirelessly defends the memorial's interests and, most importantly, Abraham Hershey's affairs. Both things are usually mixed up together. Jacoby is single, has no family in town, and few close friends. His personal life is non-existent, and his social life is usually tied to his bosses. He is 34 years old. It's important to note that Jacoby has a few dark secrets. While at work, he usually snorts cocaine in his office's bathroom, which is shared with his boss. And Jacoby suffers from pyrophobia. What remains an even darker secret is that he developed this as a child when his parents both died and he was badly hurt in a fire when his house burned to the ground. That's the part Jacoby still recalls, but the cause of the fire was his father's experiments on spontaneous human combustion. It was erased from Jacoby's memory. Then we have details on Christine McBride. She is red-headed and green-eyed. She's very fit and dresses fashionably. She is a 32 years old psychiatrist working for the memorial for little more than a year. A workaholic who quickly got to lead her specialty. She teaches at New York University, from where she already knew Laura Hansen and other of the people involved in this scenario. She works as a doctor at Ernest Spencer and also has a private practice in Manhattan. Although she may appear to be dispersed by so many activities, McBride is a very dedicated and responsible employee. She has achieved promising results in the psychiatric ward, which has created discomfort among the other doctors who have been working there for far more years than her. There are rumors that Christine McBride is involved in a romantic relationship with Matthew Lowry, the memorial's clinical director. However, this relationship is quite twisted. She does have a sort of connection with Matthew Lowry, but not quite the romantic type. McBride is a coprophiliac, someone who takes sexual pleasure out of excrement. Her paraphilia is most likely the reason why she decided to study psychiatry, but that's beside the point. Lowry, on the other hand, takes no pleasure or sexual arousal out of handling feces, but McBride is a very beautiful woman who doesn't care about his erectile dysfunction, so he's game, even if she wants him to defecate over her bosom. And McBride feels like she is getting the better deal. She believes he will not run the risk of divulging her naughty little secret because he has his own indiscretions to hide. Also, she finds him cute. And these are just some of the many non-player characters that you can encounter, that you can interact with in this module. And you could be thinking, what exactly connects this scenario to Orpheum Lofts? Well, it is precisely the background of some of these non-player characters that even make their appearance in the other scenario that link both scenarios and the connections between the different non-player characters together. There's also a very useful section detailing plot hooks. These contain randomly generated events. They are not as dark as other things. Let me read some of them to you. You have the antique desk. It's a busy day at the memorial, and that's an unexpected thing at this hospital. So there must be some kind of reason to explain an influx of patients. This could result in several things. For example, there's a high school not far from the memorial. Today, the cantina served spoiled food, and there are 60 teenagers and 15 teachers suffering from food poisoning. They had stomach complaints and nausea, and were immediately rushed to the memorial. Or perhaps there's a gathering of H.P. Lovecraft fans at Red Hook's waterfront, and a group of particularly enthusiastic readers enacts a ritual of corpse reanimation. The dead and bloated corpse of a drowned man rises from the channel waters, giving rise to panic. Hundreds are hurt, all of them lose sanity. These are just some of the events. Maybe you want to roll in the occult books table. Perhaps you obtain the result of The Book of Lies by Aleister Crowley, The Vermis Mysteries by Ludwig Prynne, The Lesser Key of Solomon, a compilation, Secrets of the Knights Templar by Colonel Ardenti. Perhaps you obtain the result of the Unaussprechlichen Kulten by von Juntz, The Book of Saint Cyprian, The Arte Cabalistica by Johannes Rochlin. Perhaps you want to feature the Hugh Hefner Appreciation Society. A few years ago, Dr. Guy Sitzman started a sort of informal gentleman's club at the memorial. The Hugh Hefner Appreciation Society, which organizes parties and other forms of entertainment aimed exclusively at male doctors. Depending on your role, the plot hook could be organizing the club or reorganizing the club rather, or simply coming up with new activities. Perhaps you obtain the results of birthday events. On every club member's birthday, the organizer should think of something dashing or funny to surprise the celebrant. Naked women jumping out of cakes and college-style pranks are quite valued. Perhaps you obtain the result of April Fools. Every April 1st, the organizers come up with a funny prank. Usually the pranked ones should not be club members. Then we have a section featuring supporting cast. Not necessarily less important than the ones in the VIP lounge, these characters are less influential. Nurses, security guards, and other employees who, by hierarchical position, are probably a lesser threat to player characters. So you have people such as Bill Brown. He is a gray-haired, lean, black man. He usually dresses in overalls and limps heavily on the right leg. He is a handyman at Ernest Spencer Memorial. He is 67 years old and the most senior employee. In fact, Bill was literally born at the hospital and spent much of his childhood there. His parents were both part of the hospital staff, his mother a cleaning lady and his father also a handyman. He has some dark secrets, his strong connection to the supernatural presence in the memorial being one of them, probably because he was born at the hospital and spent most of his life inside its walls. It's even possible that he has a strong connection to the other side in general, but that doesn't really matter, as he rarely leaves the building for more than a few hours. Then we have details on Sally O'Connor, a short, slim, very pale, extremely quiet woman. She has no fashion sense at all. She's 34 years old and a nurse at the memorial, a shy and sad woman who avoids talking to other people whenever possible. In her work breaks, she spends her time alone reading romantic novels. She lives in a world apart and is mocked by most of her colleagues. There are also details on Annabelle Devereaux. Medium height and build, with long blonde hair, most likely dyed blonde, she is a chain smoker. Dr. Devereaux is the general internist chief. She is also a bitter, shallow, and vain woman. Once a coveted Southern belle, now on the wrong side of her 40s, maybe 50s, she will not tell her real age. Annabelle doesn't take aging lightly. It didn't help that her husband, Albert Devereaux, also an MD, left her for a male nurse, 20 years her junior. And she has a dark secret. She believes blood is life. In an attempt to recover her gun looks and youth, she decided to try Elizabeth Bathory's beauty tips. Once in a while, she steals blood supplies from the hospital's blood bank and bathes in it. So perhaps one day, she will take a nice warm blood bath. And these are just some of the characters that you can encounter in the section featuring supporting cast. They are there to present perhaps obstacles, or maybe they could be allies. It all depends on how the situation unfolds. There's even a section featuring supporting cast plot hooks. Let me read some of them to you. You have someone's left foot. At the end of another shift, Bill Brown goes down to the basement, where he has been sleeping for some months since he got evicted. He has a makeshift room down there, equipped with some household appliances. As always, he goes straight for the fridge to grab a cold one, but finds something highly unusual. There's a severed human foot inside the freezer. Brown's not easily scared, and he has been around for long. At first, he just shrugs and smiles, thinking to himself that the Hefner's Appreciation Society members are getting bolder by the day. But then he starts to wonder, isn't this too much for a prank? And it's not even April Fool's yet. We also have the Midnight Meat Truck, a battered old ambulance of a model that hasn't been used in New York since the 1970s, has been allegedly spotted near the hospital several times during last year. At least one nurse and two orderlies claim that they have seen the strange ambulance in different occasions, always late at night, stopping close to the emergency entrance. When they approached the ambulance, they noticed that the windows were steamed up and nothing could be seen inside. Every witness then proceeded to call security, but when they came back, there was no ambulance there. Now, considering this scenario happens in a hospital, you would think that there is information on patients. But because patients are coming and going, they are not all detailed, of course, but you do have some background information concerning several psychiatric ward patients that are quite unpredictable and could add further chaos to whatever situation happens in the site. And believe it or not, that's just a small glimpse of all the material contained in this module. There are so many hooks, adventure seats, background information, biographies, agendas concerning all of the non-player characters there that could even be used as player characters. So what do I think of The Memorial, the second scenario in the Giallo trilogy? I think this is an awesome scenario just like the other, very sophisticated in its approach. If there is something that makes this stand apart from Orpheum Lofts is that Orpheum Lofts feels more like a normal situation, taking some dark and twisted developments for the worse. But when it comes to The Memorial, because it is a hospital from the very start, and hospitals are quite disturbing in general, especially in current times, the player characters and the players themselves are immediately touched by this sense of foreboding. I also think that Orpheum Lofts is a bit more of a slow burn, potentially, while The Memorial, because patients are coming and going, and the doctors are always busy, and every non-player character has something to do related to the hospital and its dubious practices, this module has a bit more of a quicker pace by comparison. I highly recommend that you get The Memorial and Orpheum Lofts as well. I hope you enjoyed the information revealed in this review, and I invite you to watch the conclusion of this trilogy of my review featuring these Giallo scenarios. These scenarios are some of the most versatile, most flexible horror scenarios that I have seen in my role-playing game career. Thank you for watching this review, and thank you so much to those of you that have been supporting the channel by sending the Drive-Thru RPG gift certificates. If anyone else wants to further support the channel, the information on how to do that will be in the description below. Once again, thank you. If you have any comments or questions, please let me know. See you later.